So today we'll be looking into the analysis part of ICJ, that is International Court of Justice, as well as that of Kulbhushan Jadhav case. So moving on to ICJ, the International Court of Justice, it was established in 1945 by a charter of United Nations. It is the principal judicial wing of United Nations and hence is also known as World Court. Its headquarters is at The Hague, that is at Netherlands, and also its composition is of 15 judges who have been elected for a period of 9 years. And they are elected by the United Nations Security Council as well as United Nations General Assembly. Moving on to the jurisdiction, it has jurisdiction to rule in disputes pertaining to the member states, UN member states. In fact, it has dual jurisdiction. First one is with regards to advisory jurisdiction, wherein it provides legal opinions and recommendations on matters referred to it by the organs and specialized agencies of UN. The next one is with regards to the jurisdiction in contentious cases, wherein disputes of legal nature which are taken or submitted to it by the states or the member states. The judgments are considered to be binding as per the Act 94 of UN Charter, which asks the members to consider them as binding and adhere to by these by the ICJ verdicts, and hence there is no appeal against these verdict. In fact, in cases of non-compliances which may occur in cases wherein the member states don't accept or do not accept such verdicts which are against them, they may be the aggrieved states can approach the United Nations Security Council to get it resolved. Now, why it is in news? The basic reason why it is in news is with regards to Kulbhushan Jadhav case. On May 18, 2017. ICJ, based on Indian request, issued a provisional order directing Pakistan to stop the execution of Kulbhushan Jadhav, an Indian national who has been arrested, tried and sentenced to death by the infamous military court in Pakistan. Pakistan was also asked to inform the court about the measures that it would take in order to implement this order. Coming to the significance of ICJ, first and foremost, we can say the universal character of ICJ that matters a lot or that is significant in today's world. Any of the 192 member states of UN can be parties to cases before it and in election process to the judges or to ICJ. Also, the jurisdiction covers the entire field of international law, which includes land, maritime boundary, environmental law, etc. So, everything is covered under this international law. With regards to certain other cases wherein the respondent states do not actively take part in the ICJ proceedings or even boycott the ICJ proceeding, the ICJ verdicts help in mobilizing international opinion against those respondent states, which may result in the respondent states actually complying with the ICJ orders later in the longer period or in seriously denting the public credibility or the international credibility of such respondent states. So this actually helps in mobilizing an international opinion against such nations. The most important part is that states which are serious of wanting peaceful settlement of their borders in accordance with the law and are ready to make sacrifices, ICJ helps in bringing a mechanism to do so. Now, moving on to the critical analysis or the negatives of ICJ, the absence of binding force or the absence of an enforcement agency or an enforcement mechanism means that the member states do not necessarily have to accept the verdicts or the jurisdiction of ICJ. Which means that it is a consent of each state to follow the jurisdiction that matters rather than merely being members. In fact, there are in cases wherein the ICJ verdicts are not followed by the respondent states, the aggrieved states can take this to the UN Security Council, wherein these are taken up by resolutions, and based upon this resolution, the verdicts of ICJ are actually enforced. So what happens is that there are cases wherein the UNSC veto resolutions are introduced by the P5 members in order to protect their interests or in order to protect their allies. So in such cases, what happens is that the ICJ verdicts or the ICJ rulings merely remains on paper rather than being enforced on practically on the ground. The next criticism is with regards to that the clause that is only states can take forward the cases before ICJ. No voluntary organizations, no private enterprises or no individuals can take up the cases before ICJ, which means that potential victims of crimes against humanity by state, that is essentially that of the recent Rohingya cases, wherein the state itself is acting against these Rohingyas, cannot be actually taken forward in ICJ. So this is another criticism against ICJ. The other one is with regards to the existence of parallel international courts. There are several other international courts also, with that is the International Criminal Court and such other case other courts, which means that all these international courts are working independently. So this creates a dualistic structure between these courts, which effectively makes it difficult to have an effective and a collective jurisdiction in the international sphere. Now moving on to the Kulbhushan Jadhav case. As you all know, Kulbhushan Jadhav was a former Indian naval officer. He was claimed to have been arrested by Pakistan from Balochistan and was sentenced to death by Pakistan's field general court martial. In fact, Pakistan's version was that Jadhav was involved in coordinating and organizing espionage activities with an intent to destabilize and wage a war against Pakistan. India has also made repeated requests for consular access to Jadhav for 18 times, in fact 18 times, but it was denied by the judgment, it was denied by Pakistan. And also India has asked for a certified copy of the charge sheet as well as a judgment. These two requests were actually denied by Pakistan, and the repeated denial of Pakistan led India to drag Pakistan to ICJ on May 8th of 2017 for violating Vienna Convention on Consular Relations, 1963. India also expressed the fear that Pakistan may execute the formal naval officer even before the hearing of ICJ completes. Indian argument is built around the Vienna Convention of Consular Relations, that's the optional protocol. This optional protocol accords primacy to ICJ in disputes arising out of interpretation and application of Vienna Convention on Consular Relations. In fact, it has been signed and accorded by both states, that's India and Pakistan. India has strategically invoked the Article 36 of Vienna Convention, which provides that when a national of a foreign country is arrested or detained on a criminal or immigration charges, the detainee must be advised of right to have the detainee's consulate notified, and that the detainee has the right to regular consultation with the consular officials during the detention and any trial. India also has invoked the Article 41 of ICJ statute, which empowers ICJ, if circumstances so require, to come up with any provisional measures which must be taken to preserve the respective rights of either party. The provisional measure here is because India fears that Jadhav may be executed even before ICJ completes the entire hearing of this case. So moving on to the Pakistan's argument, Pakistan has invoked the bilateral agreement on consular access 2008 that was signed between India and Pakistan. In this, actually, the bilateral agreement states that in case of arrest, detention or sentence made on political or security grounds, each side may examine the case on its merit, and based upon it they may take the actions. So the political or security grounds means that in case of spies, etc., they can actually take the required steps as the need arises. So Pakistan has invoked this bilateral agreement and justified its decision to not give India consular access to Jadhav, as he was a spy and tried in a fair manner. In fact, a fair manner was that Pakistan has claimed, but again, it was a secretive military trial. It further argued that under this bilateral agreement, it denies ICJ of its jurisdiction in such matters between India and Pakistan. Now moving on to the ICJ observations. ICJ has observed that Pakistan's actions were not keeping in with that of the international norms, that of the Vienna Convention. It has also rejected the objections raised by Pakistan to its jurisdiction, that is ICJ's jurisdiction, to take up the case based on the 2008 bilateral agreement, and which means that the subordination of 2008 bilateral agreement to Vienna Convention is a huge victory for India, and it also prevents Pakistan from proceeding against Indian nationals in secret trials or other military trials. Now moving on to the implication, there are positive as well as negative implications for this. The major positive one is that India is signaling to its citizens and also to the international community that it is willing to step in and ensure the protection of rights of its citizens wherever they are violated anywhere in the world. So this is one of the biggest advantage that has been projected out of this Kulbhushan Jadhav case. The second one is that the Vienna Convention is accorded a greater primacy over the bilateral agreements wherein the life of its citizens are concerned. And these citizens may or may not be alleged as spies or terrorists. By publicizing the entire issue, India has actually exposed Pakistan's double standard. In fact, there has been Pakistan has been building up a whole story around this Jadhav case. It has alleged that Jadhav was a spy, a terrorist, and hence were not providing consular access. Because if consular access was provided, India would have known the entire truth from where he was abducted, from where he was actually operating, and other states. In fact, India has also said that spies won't be given Indian passports. But in this case, the Pakistan claims to say that Kulbhushan Jadhav was having a valid Indian passport, which is against the normal norms. Now, moving on to the implications, the negative implications of this issue is that it is actually a paradigm shift as far as India-Pakistan bilateral relations are concerned. India has always given bilateral measures or bilateral mechanisms in order to resolve issues between India and Pakistan. But in 1974, India has actually given a written submission to ICJ stating that it will not accept ICJ's jurisdiction or ICJ's role in resolving disputes with regards to those states, that is, with regards to past or present Commonwealth countries. And Pakistan is actually a Commonwealth country. In 1999, there was an issue wherein a Pakistani naval reconnaissance plane was shot down by India in Sir Creek. And when Pakistan took India to ICJ using this very 1974 issue or the 1974 agreement, ICJ ruled in favor of India. It is this part that actually is changed, or it is this stand that is actually changed with this Kulbhushan Jadhav case. In fact, here, though India has argued that it is fearing for the life or the life of its citizen, the experts feel that this issue or this very opening may be misused by Pakistan in the upcoming issues. So this is one of the negative aspects as far as India-Pakistan issues or bilateral relations are concerned. So this is something like opening a Pandora's box. India has the only option of taking this issue to UN Security Council. Again, there are three speculations that happens. First one, in UN Security Council, the resolution may be vetoed by its all-weather ally, that is China. The second one, UN Security Council refuses to intervene in this case as it is a bilateral issue between India and Pakistan. Third one, UN Security Council intervenes and asks Pakistan to adhere to the ICJ ruling, which again is bleak in its possibility. So these three will not ensure that ICJ rulings will be adhered to by the Pakistan, that is providing consular access as well as ensuring a fair and a transparent fair trial in a civilian court. Now moving on to the suggestion part, first and foremost, the best one is to resolve it through bilateral means, that is going for bilateral resolution would increase the acceptability and compliance by both parties. Again, you can also use the diplomatic skills to coerce Pakistan to follow ICJ rulings and give consular access and ensure a fair public trial through civilian court is given to Kulbhushan Jadhav. Again, the other possibility is to set up a joint team with equal representations from both the countries to conduct a fair, time-bound investigations to verify the charges leveled across Jadhav. But in any case, more than going for ICJ ruling, India should ensure that bilaterally it is able to secure the Jadhav's release or Jadhav's consular access.